Hello, welcome to episode 172 of the Go Beyond Disruption podcast, bringing you weekly insights from inside the accounting and finance profession that help you stay ahead of the curve, wherever you're based and whatever your role. It's one of many podcasts brought to you by the Association of International Certified Professional Accountants, the unified voice of the AICPA and CIMA, and I'm Kyle Hannan, based at the AICPA and CIMA UK office in the heart of London's financial district. It's the end of September 2021, and that means we're continuing our monthly exploration of what it means to disrupt yourself and to go solo. And this time, our sample journey, which looks at someone who goes from working for someone else to working for themselves, is now in month two. Now, last time we talked about what could happen in month one. That's making the decision to strike out on your own and to leave, well, wherever you were working. So this month, month two, we'll be looking at the first month of going solo. You're out on your own, and we're looking at developing partnerships and raising awareness. And even though these special monthly episodes are called Going Solo, I wouldn't dream of trying to tackle this topic by myself, which is why I'm joined again by my guest, David Peters. Lots of people already know you and what you do, so for those who don't, give yourself a quick introduction.
Yeah, absolutely. So Kyle, again, thanks for having me on. I enjoy doing this podcast with you, and I appreciate you taking the time to have a conversation with me and giving me a chance to share some thoughts here. So I'm a financial advisor and a tax practitioner. I have my main home is in Richmond, Virginia. Before I got started doing that, though, I was the first CFO of compare.com, which is a price comparison website for auto insurance rates. And I used to work very closely with Admiral Group in the UK, which is a very large auto insurer. And so I've been around startups, and I've advised for startups for several years. And I've spent most of my career working for startups. When I was working for compare.com, it was a startup. Before that, when I was working for Elephant Auto Insurance, it was a startup. And a lot of my clients are startups. So I do a lot of client work for startups. I also do a lot of seminars and courses, continuing education courses centered around small businesses. So I'm working on a course for the AICPA right now, the Small Business Advisor Program, which is a series of courses that just talk about sort of all of the aspects of advising for small businesses. So that's probably within those spaces. That's where people would probably be most likely to be familiar with my work.
Good. And with those small business advisory resources and that content coming up in the future, you sound like just the right person to be talking to right now here today. So let's just look at where we were a month ago. At the end of August 2021, we looked at this for the first time. That was going solo month one. Where were we then? Just summarize where we were at the end of that month in the sample journey as someone is making that transition from employment to whatever comes next.
Well, I think that last month, I think if I was going to just kind of sum it up, I would say that last month was really about that decision point. Everyone to some degree is looking out there and wondering, hey, I wonder if I could go out on my own. So we're looking and we're seeing a perceived need. We're maybe seeing an opportunity. We're seeing something that we are passionate about, something that we can do differently, better, we think, than somebody else. And that was really kind of the focus of our conversation last time. You know, we were talking about how, you know, how whenever you go out on your own, whenever you go solo, to some degree, you're trying to change mindsets a lot of the time. I mean, a lot of the time, you are trying to get people to look at a new product or a service in a different way. I mean, because that's where you think the opportunity is a lot of times. And so we were talking about you evaluating your ability to do that. There is a sense that when you go out on your own, that you're kind of you're working without a net. And so the idea of going out on your own can be pretty intimidating. that's pretty normal. It's pretty normal to be sort of intimidated by the decision. And we also talked about how passion is usually the thing that kind of tips people into the space that they decide that going solo is the right thing for them. But ultimately, what pushes somebody to go out on their own, at least in my experience, I think what pushes people out there is passion. They have to be passionate about it. And they just decide at some point, you know what, hey, I just need to figure out if I can do this. Sink or swim, I wanted to try it. And so we talked a lot about that. And then we really sort of gave, I guess, kind of a primer for today's conversation, because we started talking about partnerships and raising awareness. And I think that those are two things that are very important, especially when you're first getting started.
Indeed. So a month in, if you think back to where we were, that would have been the month that people would have been essentially working out their notice period. And coming to the end of the month now, essentially in the sample journey that we're tracking, they may be about to leave. They'll be in the last few days of that previous role. They've made the plans. They're driven by the passion that you spoke about. They are now about to begin their first month as an independent or self-employed or a gig worker, a specialist, whatever direction and entity that they've decided on.
Right.
So let's talk about the basics, the practicals. What kind of things do you think someone starting their first month as a non-employed person, what do they have to think about? What are the basics, the kind of the boring stuff?
Logistics are important. We do need to begin to look for office space, maybe trying to figure out, registration with the state or whatever regulatory body, maybe getting a business license, those types of things. There are some logistics that we have to take care of. So I don't want that to sort of float by in our conversation. Certainly, we want to get some of those logistics in place. What I see sometimes is that whenever we go out on our own, we tend to lean on the things that we are most comfortable with. And for a lot of accountants, for a lot of financial folks, a lot of that is the logistics piece. You know, it's making sure that we are registered with the state, making sure that we have office space in place, making sure that we, if we have like software contracts that we need to read, things like that. We're good at that. Personally, I think that is something that I do pretty well. However, I would actually say that that's less important than telling people what you're doing. The crux of our conversation today, I think, is how to get the word out there about this new journey that we're taking. We talked a lot about that notice period last time, but it's always important to make sure that we are not burning any bridges on the way out the door. But, if they're asking about what you're doing, tell them. There's nothing wrong with that. In that process, we're thinking about, okay, how do I get the message out there? How do I get this in front of people? And that can really be the challenge is that we got to figure out how to talk about us and how to talk about what we're doing. And I think for a lot of financial folks, I think that that feels uncomfortable.
That's got to be a challenge, isn't it? How would you suggest that people starting off in their first month of going solo can put themselves out there, not just as a particular and recognizable service, but as something that is recognizably different, especially when no one's heard of them yet?
I think that's really tough. I think that you're absolutely correct. For me, I focused in on trying to develop relationships that I already had. I tried to develop my message, tried to tinker with my message until I got it to something that I was comfortable with. I practiced on friends and family and people that I knew, a very forgiving audience, if you will. After you get better at delivering that message, then at some point you need to take it out to the public somehow. For me, one of the ways that I chose to help make people aware of what I was doing is I started volunteering a lot more. And I would volunteer for groups that were related to what I was doing. It was an easy way to make connections in the community. and it was an easy way to get in front of people. When you meet someone for the first time, one of the first questions that you ask is, what do you do? So it's a very easy in when you're meeting people to just tell them what you're doing. I am self-employed and I have decided to start my own financial advising firm. And I've been at it for a month and this is what I've done so far.
You said something very interesting when you talked about getting in front of people. But one of the things, of course, one is encouraged to do these days is to find a way of being alongside your prospective clients, in some way being able to immerse yourself into the things that they're likely to be doing so that they discover you where they already are. That could be, as you say, volunteering or meeting them at local events or groups on LinkedIn, etc.
Right.
Talk us through some of the different legal entities, the legal status that you as a solo professional could consider exploring, because we've all heard that you could be a consultant, you could be a partner, you could be self-employed. Different things mean different things in different parts of the world. What are some of the options there?
So you could address this question in a few ways. The first one is talking about sort of formal legal entities. And that is certainly a part of the conversation. We need to put something in place in order to get started. However, as my grandmother would say, don't overcook it. Don't spend so much time working through the perfect legal entity that we end up almost wasting time, because the right entity now may not necessarily be the right entity a few years from now when business is growing and when the challenges are different. So a lot of times when I'm talking to small business owners and they're just getting started, we're not looking at exit planning. Every now and again, Kyle, I'll sit through a presentation on small businesses and the presenter will say something about how we need to think as far down the road as we possibly can, and that will help us find the right entity for this particular business. In theory, I think that that is a solid concept. However, in reality, I don't think it works. Most of my clients, and me included in that, when we're starting a business, we're not thinking about exit planning. We're not thinking about 25 years from now. We just don't have that roadmap together yet. So a lot of times when we're working with clients, a lot of times we are just trying to give them some flexibility and give them some protection. And so we need to put a legal entity in place, and we have to take care of some logistics. That's what we just mentioned a few minutes ago. There are some logistics that we need to put in place. Having a legal entity in place for now is probably something that we have to do. A lot of times, we are trying to limit liability and provide some flexibility. In the United States, sometimes the right choice then can be an LLC. Obviously, we got to look at all of the factors and the circumstances, and we do have to take into account individual situations, but LLCs offer that limited protection and give us some flexibility.
And what does LLC actually stand for?
It stands for Limited Liability Company.
Gotcha.
And we have similar structures in other countries. So, for example, the limited company in the UK, both of those would be approximately equivalent. But the goal here is not to pick the entity for the next 25 years. The goal here is to put in the legal entity as a placeholder and give us some flexibility so that down the road, we'll be able to move into something that is more permanent and more appropriate for our situation in the future. So I think that that is an important idea because it's not going to be a one and done. It's not going to be something that we are going to make the entity decision one time, and then once that's done, it is set in stone and we can't ever change it. There are very few things that when we work in startups that are going to be the same now that are going to be the same, you know, 10 years from now. We just don't operate that way. You just don't know all of the factors and all of the things that are going to happen. And I think that for a lot of professionals that are moving out on their own, that's a bit of a surprise. We can't predict everything. And so we need to be okay with being wrong and having to make changes.
You talked about tapping into your existing network. There may be opportunities in working with people you know, not perhaps as previous clients, but perhaps as part of your own business, working either as co-consultants or kind of informal partners. You might be able to outsource something you need to someone else, or someone else who may have been doing this for a lot longer than you, be able to use you as something they're outsourcing. So if you are considering working with friends or someone that you may have had a loose professional contact with in the past, what are some of the things you should bear in mind if you think, well, I don't need to really get set up all on my own because I can just work with some people I know? You've got to think of that also as a stepping stone rather than an end goal, haven't you? And then how do you plan to move on beyond that?
Yeah, and I think that is a great point. When you're working, when you're out there, when you are living life, you meet people and you figure out what these people do. And there are certain people that you gravitate towards and they gravitate towards you. And most of the time, my experience is that your friends are usually happy for you when you've gone out on your own. And sometimes that can present an opportunity where you can leverage some of the resources that they have, some of the office space that they have, some of the skills that they have, and you can create a partnership. And sometimes it's a formal partnership, sometimes it's a contract, other times it's not. Sometimes it is informally picking someone's brain over tea or lunch, where we get a chance to just ask some questions, and most of the time, your friends will help you out. And I think that is an important aspect of that first month, is that you're really trying to create partnerships. You're not necessarily looking to the hard sell. You're not looking for the perfect client, necessarily. You are looking to create some partnerships that might be helpful in the future. And that's a lot of what drives what I said earlier. Tell people about what you're doing, because most of the time they're going to be happy for you. So it's going to give you a little bit of a boost. And everybody needs a little bit of encouragement when they go out on their own, because there's always that little tinge of doubt that we might be wrong. And I think it's also good, too, from a business perspective. I mean, they may be able to offer things to you, and you may be able to offer things to them.
That must be quite difficult as someone who may have been working, let's say, as an employee for years and years. Every time you met someone, perhaps out and about, you would have been so used to responding to people, limited by the fact that you're already an employee, no matter what opportunities or prospects for working together you may see with other professionals you encounter, people who may be friends or acquaintances in your professional sector. As an employee, you could never actually take those conversations anywhere because you were already working for someone else. But now it's quite a shift in mindset to actually now realize that as a solo professional, you can take those conversations further than perhaps you may have been able to take them when you were an employee. So this is quite disruptive and it is quite exciting.
Bingo.
So have more courage. I think that's the big thing, but always keep your wits about you. That's useful. All right. So you talked about choosing the right legal entity, using it as a placeholder, having those conversations in ways that perhaps you hadn't been able to do when you were still employed. And bearing in mind where we are in this conversation about going solo, we're now in month two. So the first month was giving notice and working out your notice period. So we've come to the end of that month. Now we're about to start that first month working solo. And you were talking about putting what you do in front of people, being distinctive, having something, a service, an offer, a product, But not everything is a hard sell, unless, of course, you don't know what you're selling, in which case then it is hard to sell. So you have to think about not only what you're putting in front of people, but let's say you've got something which is clearly delineated. You have to think about advertising, haven't you? So let's talk about that. That's a conventional approach. People would say, right, I'm out going solo. I need to be advertising. Dave, tell us where advertising may or may not be such a good idea and when we know that we're ready for it. So where would you normally suggest that someone considering advertising their new business should start?
I think it depends on what you're naturally comfortable with. My approach to advertising is probably a bit less traditional than maybe some other people out there. Because when I think about marketing, when I think about advertising my product, I think about it in terms of any time that I am telling somebody about my product, about my service, that itself is advertising. So I think that there are informal ways to advertise. Again, word of mouth, talking to people, telling people about what you're doing. I think that is advertising. I think that volunteering and getting the opportunity to get in front of people, that is advertising. I think that going to events and getting in front of people and talking, having informal conversations over lunch, I think is advertising. All of those things.
Yes, because to many people, there may have been this idea that advertising was what you paid for and everything else was promotion, really. And you're saying that you have to think of everything essentially as advertising.
Correct.
And whether you're promoting, whether you're advertising, it's all going to cost something, whether it's money, whether it's time, whether it's effort. And you can't do all of those things. So when I look at advertising, let's say we're considering paying for advertising. Mm-hmm. We've got something to sell. We've got a brand. We've got a catchphrase and a slogan. Where would you say that people should be advertising? Would it be now or would it be much, much later once you've got the promotional approach and strategies down pat first?
I think you have to make sure that your message is something that you think is going to resonate. Not that it's going to be perfect, but you've tested it out, at least formally or informally. You could use test groups. That's one approach. You could also be more informal about it, which has been what I have been talking about, where I just test it out on family and friends or over lunch. I say, what do you think about this as a catchphrase? This as a slogan? What do you think about that? Is that interesting or is that not interesting? What do you think? So you have to at least develop some message before you can really test it out. If I'm going to pay for advertising, where do I want to do that? You have to think about where your customers are. We don't want to think about putting dollars into something if our customers are not going to be there.
Everyone looks great on a billboard, but if none of your customers are going to be driving past it, then what's the point?
And two, is billboard advertising going to be effective for your particular customer base? Right now, especially, a lot of companies are using email advertising and trying to get the word out that way. I'm trying to get out my message so I can either purchase email lists or maybe I am using my existing network through LinkedIn or some other social media platform to get my message out. There's nothing wrong with that, but the problem is, how is the customer, your potential customer, how are they going to react to that? Is it just noise? Because I can tell you, I get a lot of emails in a day, and I got a very fast trigger finger. I delete email messages really, 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 really fast. And so if that is the case, if you don't think that your clients are going to notice that message coming through, that's probably not a good spend. If you think, though, that a billboard may be a good way of doing things because you know that a lot of your customer base is going to, you know, be driving down a particular road and it's at a spot that is noticeable, maybe that's the way to go.
Like outside the local tax office.
Absolutely. And I think that can be powerful. I have one friend of mine who is in financial advising, and he tried doing things like Google ads and several other things through the internet. And ultimately what he decided was, is it wasn't reaching his customers. His customers were primarily retirees, and he found that the most effective advertising for them was to send out newsletters mailed out on paper, and that was a good way to get their attention because it was something that they could hold and read. I think that that's a great example of going where your clients are. If we're going to advertise, I don't want to waste advertising dollars. Most of the time, if I'm starting a business, money's tight anyway. So we need to figure out where, as the old saying goes, where I'm going to get the most bang for my buck.
And of course, based on where you are in the world, you've got to think about privacy. You've got CCPA, GDPR, all of those increasingly privacy-first restrictions on what you can do with people's data, with mailing lists, with opt-in, opt-outs, et cetera, with marketing. So you may have thought that up until a couple of years ago, email marketing or online advertising or tracking pixels or cookies on internet web browsers with a way that you can kind of reach people. But that's becoming less and less the case.
Correct.
And as you say, going back to the basics sometimes might seem an unconventional disruption, but it is something that is increasingly more effective because you certainly don't have to ask for people to sign an opt-in when you're handing over a business card, having a real face-to-face conversation at a networking group. So that certainly is true. Now, talking about the people you meet and the customers themselves and the personalization of it, focusing on them first, this is a new disruption here, especially during the pandemic. We are seeing things change. People are changing what they expect from existing businesses, and they're coming to new businesses with demands that will be based on how the big businesses they've dealt with have been able to meet their needs. So you're kind of up against the big boys, even when you start as a small one. So
correct.
What are some of these customer demands that and realities of the meeting of those demands that new businesses have to be aware of?
I don't think I'm going to blow anybody's mind here. It's all about demand, speed, and customization. Demand. Expectations for service and personalized products are very, very high right now. People want things that are tailored to them. As you said, they want things that are tailored to them, products and especially financial services. They don't want, just as an example, someone to do their tax return. They want somebody who is going to go over the tax return with them, who is going to put the rules and the papers that they receive in front of them and say, okay, this is what is going on with your return. Demand. Demand is very high for personalized products. Speed. People are wanting things faster and faster and faster and faster. And I think that that is something that we need to address. Depending on the business, that could mean a number of things. If it's financial services, maybe we are looking for ways to get information out more quickly. Maybe we are when there is a highly anticipated tax bill that may be passed. I know that there's a few of them that, as we're recording this, that are going on in the United States right now. If there is something like that that you think that your customers are going to be especially interested in, maybe the speed factor is not so much that you're necessarily doing the service faster than you were previously, but maybe it is about getting them information about that new tax bill in the quickest way possible, getting them a blog post or some sort of email out right away, or a newsletter, or maybe you offer a webinar or something like that where you get a chance to be kind of the first voice that people hear in the conversation because they are looking to you for expertise.
Ah, that's the partnership aspect of
correct
what you're talking about, because of course this episode is looking at developing partnerships, raising awareness. And you're saying that you have to be kind of super serving these people as a partner. And by understanding their situation, giving them information which is more pertinent to them, you may not be doing it faster than much bigger companies, but what you are doing is giving them an insight, giving them information which helps them respond to their situation or make a decision more quickly because your information is better and more pertinent to them.
Correct. Because again, people don't want just information. They want information that's going to be customized. They want solutions that are specific to them. And I think that if you can't be faster than a bigger company, maybe what you can do is possibly create a service or a product that is more customized, and that more customized product gets to people faster. Maybe that's the way to approach things. So I think that there's ways to do that. I think we also have to recognize, though, too, that by its very nature, advertising is disruptive. Marketing is disruptive. When you are putting things out there, it's not going to be the same conversations that you're used to having with these people. And I think that that is the part that makes people uncomfortable. If I am used to talking to you in a particular way, Kyle, we talked about kind of the way that we interact on a day-to-day basis with my colleagues in a particular work environment where maybe we're both employees of the same company, we interact in a particular way. When we meet with the same person outside of the office environment, when we are no longer an employee, the dynamics change, the dynamics of the relationship change, and the conversation hopefully changes as well. And that's okay. It may feel a little awkward at first, but you have to find ways to tell people about what you're doing. In my experience, sometimes the best way to do it is to suggest rather than necessarily beat someone over the head with an idea. So if I say, Kyle, I think I have a decent idea. What would you think about this? So I'm thinking about offering a new financial product, and I think it would be good for someone like you. And here's why. Would that be interesting? Am I telling you what I'm doing? Yeah. Am I doing it in a way that is suggesting and trying to get feedback and trying to partner with you? Yeah. And that's why it's effective.
And also, it's a great way of seeing what people think about your ideas. They may come back and go, yeah, it's kind of interesting. But actually, what would interest me even more is your idea plus this thing, which reflects their actual needs. And then you're going, oh, that's a bit of market research that I've just conducted without realizing I was doing it.
Correct.
So, David, just to look ahead at the first month, essentially what we're doing now is we've just left our company. We are now going to spend our first month on our own, right? This is month two of the journey. It's the first month as a solo professional. What are some milestones you would suggest should be on everyone's calendar for, let's say, the first month of solo professional activity?
I think first and foremost, we have to constantly be thinking about delivering the message, trying to get the messaging right. And that involves marketing goals. It involves trying to set some goals for us in terms of what do we want to do from a marketing perspective. In other words, how many people do we want to reach within the next month, 2 months, 3 months? We need to start getting our message out there. And the best way to do that is to set a goal for ourselves. How are we going to take advantage of this? Something like a marketing goal, when we're talking about it here, is something like, if I decide that my potential client is going to be at certain outreach events, I'm going to go to at least two outreach events in a month. And during those outreach events, I want to tell at least 10 people about what I'm doing. Something like that. That's what we mean by marketing goals. We need to find a way to get the message out there, and that is the way to do it. Notice here, too, we're not looking at sales and return on investment and things like that. We don't have revenue really yet. And so the classic metrics that we often talk about in business, they don't exist yet. So we need to look at things in a little bit of a different way. We should also be developing what that first customer is going to look like. What's our target profile? What types of people do we want to reach? We've tested out our message formally or informally at this point, at least to some degree. So what's our customer look like and how can we reach them? And then again, I'll go back to the KPI piece. We can't use the traditional KPIs. So we need to start thinking about number of new prospects that we reach, number of outreach attempts that we have. We need to constantly be looking for ways to get our message out there. And that is the real challenge in month two, I think. Now, beyond that, I would also add that we also need to figure out how to look out for ourselves a little bit too and protect what we have. Because one of the quickest ways to kill an idea is to maybe experience an insurance claim or to get a lawsuit right out of the gate. That can end a small business. And so if we haven't looked at those things already, we need to start thinking about insurance and how exactly can we get those policies in place. In a lot of ways, your insurance is going to be a lot more important than necessarily, for example, getting the right accounting system. I can survive at least for a month or so without a good accounting system. I can't, but if I get an insurance claim in those first couple of months and I'm not covered, that could be it. And so I think it's important to start thinking about that as well, to start putting some things that that protect us in place right away.
And then if we are looking for some resources that can help us, where would you suggest that people go online to assist them as they start to move into their first month as a solo professional?
The internet is probably your best friend at this point. And the reason why I would say that is because it's free. I mean, I guess you got to pay your internet bill, I suppose. But for the most part, it's a wealth of information and it's cheap information. And there's a lot of good stuff out there. The small business, chamber of commerce, networking groups, your network on LinkedIn, I think could be good. The Federation of Small Businesses in the UK, local government websites. Those are full of good information. I would also throw out there insurance companies as well. I mean, we talked about the importance of insurance companies and getting some protection in place. A lot of your especially your larger insurance companies will have resources out there where they will talk about things that a small business should be looking for in terms of protection. So, for example, you might go out to an insurance company's website and they might talk to you about cyber insurance. And especially in this day and age where we're doing more and more things on the internet, if we're selling over the internet or if we're collecting data over the internet, how do we need to be protected in that? And your insurance companies do a very good job. A lot of them will have free resources out there that just tell you about what types of products that you need. And I think that that can be a great resource as well.
All right. And we'll put links to all of that in the show notes. And of course, as we always do at the end of every episode, David, we ask you to pick one sentence to put on the front of an imaginary Go Beyond Disruption t-shirt, not a digital one, but one you actually have to wear for real. If you had to put one sentence from this discussion we've had about going solo month two, talking about developing partnerships, raising awareness, what would you put on the front of that t-shirt?
I think that I would say that building relationships is necessarily disruptive. That's my sentence. I think that that's a good way. That really sums up what we've been talking about today, because the entire time we've been talking about partnerships. How can I build relationships with people? So I think that that's a good way to sum it up.
Sounds good to me. David Peters, financial advisor, tax practitioner, CPE instructor. And of course, Dave, I have to mention this, and perhaps you could tell people where to find it. You're also the host of the Accountable Podcast. That's one link you didn't mention. If people want to listen to that, where do they go?
If there's a few different ways that they can find Accountable. Accountable, we bill it as the podcast for CFOs by a CFO. If you're looking for Accountable, davidpetersfinancial.com is a great place to go. You can also catch the podcast, though, on basically anywhere that you can get podcasts. So those would all be great places to go.
Thank you, David. You'll be back again in 4 weeks' time to talk about month three of the journey to disrupt yourself and to go solo. Of course, there are links to all the resources that David's mentioned. You'll find those in the show notes, and you can view those really easily by clicking on this episode's info icon in the podcast app on your smartphone or your tablet, or just open the episode in your computer's web browser, and you'll find everything right there. We'd also suggest visiting our AICPA and CIMA portal, which you'll find at future.aicpa.org. That's future.aicpa.org. You can find courses, webinars, and other professional development resources, a very useful mix of free and paid-for content, so do have a browse. And if you'd like to browse our library of back episodes or share perhaps this show with your network, go to gobeyonddisruption.com. That's gobeyonddisruption.com, and you'll find all the episodes there. They're all there, all free, and also all available via almost all podcast apps and music streaming services too. Thanks again to our guest, and of course, thank you very much for listening. If you've enjoyed the episode, do tell someone about it and tell us what you think. We'd love your opinion. Perhaps tell us what you'd like to hear less of or more of. You can email us via the feedback link in the show notes, or just pop a comment under this episode's media player in whatever podcast or music app you may be using right now. From the UK office of the AICPA and CIMA in London, I'm Kyle Hannan. We'll be back soon with more conversations that help you and your profession to go beyond disruption. Till next time, keep listening and keep safe. Goodbye.
Thanks for listening to this episode of Beyond Disruption, brought to you by the Association of International Certified Professional Accountants. Learn more about today's topic at AICPA-CIMA.com/disruption. This podcast is designed to provide illustrative information with respect to the subject matter covered and does not represent an official opinion or position of the Association of International Certified Professional Accountants or any of its subsidiaries or affiliates. It is provided with the understanding that the association, its affiliates, and subsidiaries are not engaged in rendering legal, accounting, or other professional services. If such advice or expert assistance is required, the services of a competent professional person should be sought. The association, its subsidiaries, and affiliates make no representations, warranties, or guarantees as to and assume no responsibility for the content or application of the material contained herein, and expressly disclaim all liability for such damages arising out of the use of, reference to, or reliance on such material.